and Christian morality. So this organization now that is going to set up itself, this terrorist group called the Ku Klux Klan, ultimately would be called the invisible government. Because them reign terror against the black population, against Jews, and against even the white people who are were conscientious enough to support the issues of black people. These Ku Klux Klan organization can be defined as a hate group. The Ku Klux Klan practice hatred, hostility, and violence. Promote animosity, they promote malice. And they set out to attack an entire race or an entire group of people. And they try to malign them by the characteristics that they have that are inborn. So this organization, this group, set up itself in America from the 1860s. The Ku Klux Klan is still in America in 2015. It's manifested in agencies like the police force. Jim Crow laws, black codes. Jim Crow laws came into effect after the Reconstruction period, and these laws were set up again to frustrate the black people, racially segregated states and local laws. And in this racial segregation now, it became institutionalized in the economic, education, and social systems. In this period, we find that the black man under these Jim Crow laws. Sometimes we wonder who is Jim Crow, if somebody named Jim Crow. We know what crow is, you know, crow means buzzard. We don't know who Jim is. But these laws were set up to segregate the public schools in America. Segregation in the restaurants, in public places, drinking fountain, in the bus system. So the apartheid of system of separation of the races is not a South African thing. This was enforced after the Reconstruction period in America. Because between 1800 and 1865, they introduced the Black Codes. And these codes restricted civil rights and the liberties of the Africans who were in America. These laws were passed by southern states to maintain the system of white supremacy. So imagine now you want to go to the bathroom and you have to go to the one that's more colored, because when you go inside the other one, it don't do the same function. Apparently you don't sit down, you stand up and do everything. Must be something different. You go to a water fountain to drink water, you have to go to one that mark colored. You can't go to the one mark white because the water come out different. And so all this racial discrimination and segregation that has been rife at the foundation of America, I don't understand now how the criticism leveled at South Africa as being an apartheid state. America, United States of America, apartheid is the philosophy. But equal, how can that be? So on that North American scenario now, them have this political concept that they call democracy. What I find difficult to digest is how can democracy be compatible with apartheid? How can democracy be compatible with separate but equal? Because democracy says that it is a collection of people who are going to define their own governance. And in democracy, it's a government of the people, and by the people, and for the people. So who are the people in America that democracy refers to if they're practicing apartheid and segregation of the races? Something is problematic. Seems to be some sort of deception surrounding this idea of democracy. Or is it that democracy applies only to white people who are educated and wealthy? Clarity is what we need. So the black man in America, exposed to violence and brutality from before the Civil War into the post-Civil War era called the Reconstruction era, exposed to Jim Crow laws, no different from the slave codes. And in these laws, there is discrimination, prohibition, unable to access the resources of the state. So the black man in America is not in a very pretty position. And like the Caribbean, was encouraged to channel his energies into sports and entertainment. So you recognize that in North America now, we have the greatest sportsmen, greatest entertainers, football players being traded for millions of dollars. And within that same framework, there is a weakness to the law. There's a powerful force that is overriding the money that the American black man can gather. And there's a force that's also helping to extract the money. That force is the church. So the money is being generated by black people outside of the labor camp, the traditional labor force, by getting into sports and entertainment, where they make what they call big bucks. But the big bucks evaporate. Need to find where is it the money is being siphoned off into. All of these millions and millions that these sportsmen and entertainers are holding on to. I want to explore the role of the church in that North American scenario. How was the church that the black people have been conditioned to go into? How have they assisted them towards their liberation, or are they a part of the hold down? What is done with the millions of dollars collected every Sunday from the black people in the black church? Where do these monies go? Into whose bank do these monies go? Because in America now, you know, we have to talk about black banks and white banks. In the Caribbean, we just talk about banks. And the banks here are just foreign owned and they're done. But in North America, and on the American plan, if we talk about black and white, where does the money from the black church go? Does it go into black banks? Does it go into black neighborhoods? Or is it another way to siphon off the resources of the African black people in America?
Stars FM, you're my number one.
Portland, St. Mary's, Stars FM, the People's Nation is now on your radio. 96.1 and 96.7 on your FM band.
Tell a friend to tell a friend. Stars FM, your northeastern radio station based in Portland, Jamaica. Tune in now.
Architects, draftsmen, and surveyors, get your drawings printed in high-quality professional standards. We can satisfy your printing needs. Whether it is for presentation to your clients or for submitting building and subdivision application, make it VJ Printing Services. Whether drawing by hand or with computer-aided softwares, we will plot your negatives and print the copies as you need. We do high-quality white paper printing that is water-resistant and never fades, unlike traditional blueprint. For more information, call VJ Printing at 893-2266.
Yo, me I tell you, say, yo, don't miss that gelling in rush with digital tea every Saturday 4 to 8 p.m. where new music and new artists live. Yo, it's entertaining and interactive. Yo, don't miss the party hour 7 to 8. Totally. Na 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 na. Baby, when you take my picture on the camera phone, when me and the next girl carry on from the beach, yo, don't forget in the digital tea, the adrenaline rush.
Do you have or are you seeking a place to rent? Seeking employment or have a job vacancy? Are you selling a car or having a garage sale? Then come see us. Let's Tiles do the advertising for you and you'll be on your way in no time. Contact us at 876-286-9216 or 439-5160. Advertising style. Advertise with style.
How many you believe that apartheid is ended? How many people out there really and truly believe that apartheid is ended? How many people believe that the release of Nelson Mandela ended the apartheid era? How many of you really hold that as true? And let me give you the definition of apartheid. It's an official policy of racial segregation that involves political, legal, and economic discrimination against African people, where the policy and practices of separating groups of people according to their racial makeup. How many people believe that apartheid has really ended? It's deception. Deception at the highest level. Because when we look at the reality of America, where this philosophy took root from the early 1800s, said it was almost like hypocritical, chastising the government in South Africa for practicing apartheid. Because it was right in the very faces of the people, right here in North America, right here in this Western world. But because of the media creating this deception about democracy and freedom and land of the free and home of the brave, everybody got caught up into the illusion. The church has been a significant role in maintaining this deception. The black churches in America are a significant institution that holds much of the wealth and the potential wealth of the black people there. I could say the same thing for the Caribbean and specifically for Jamaica, but we can't talk about a black church in Jamaica because the population, though, is 96% Africans. They don't see themselves as 96% black people here. And because of the deception and the illusion of class, the notion of a black church, the closest that will come to in Jamaica is a church of Rastafari. Because Rastafari embraces the blackness of Africa. The other churches, Christian, coming out of the Catholic and Anglican framework, are part of the colonial structure. They use the same Bible that the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants use. So the church, an institution that helps to maintain the plantocracy. The church teaches the African people, particularly in North America and everywhere, that they don't have to worry about the present. That the greater life is in heaven. And so all the money that they accumulate in North America is not important. And the use of the money is not so critical for posterity because the greater life is in heaven. So as much as there's plenty of money being circulated through the black communities and the black hands in America, it's not directed towards building earthly structures, earthly institutions, because much of the meditation is being driven by these pastors. The thing about America and black America and the black church is that a very important pastor rose up in the black church in the early 1800s. This man was called Nat Turner. And he led a rebellion in Southampton, Virginia. And it started in August 1831. So as much as the church was trying to enslave the black mind, they were still thinkers. And Nat Turner got the title of the first, well, not the first, got the title of the Black Prophet. And we need to look up Nat Turner and study what was called the Nat Turner Rebellion. And in this revolt led by Nat Turner, the Africans who were slaves, they rise up against the colonial owners and slaughter about 55 to 65 white people because Turner said he got a vision. Yeah. So all the while we hear about visions, there's always white people getting these visions. And for the first time now, a black man in America as a pastor get a vision. But his vision didn't suit the white people because his vision was about killing them. So apparently Lord God tell him, say, must kill them. And he became a very serious threat. And so the white man realized that you can't leave the black man with the Bible alone. If you leave him alone in the Bible, we're going to find a way to get out of it. And so they created these people in the black church now called monitors. And these people would come and sit when the black man is preaching to make sure them don't say what him not say. But Turner's rebellion shook up the white people in America. In the South. I mean, they put it down in a few days, you know. Because, of course, of numbers and so forth and so on. But the message became clear. And in return, they murdered enough black people. Yeah, man, they murdered enough away. In the same way, they murdered enough away when Paul Boger rise up in Maranby. And they introduced the police force to serve and protect and to reassure the colonials. So the church now and the Bible in black America was being used as a tool to liberate black people now through rebellion. Because this vision of Nat Turner has to be respected. And if you respect the Lord for sending visions, what is wrong with the visions sent to Nat Turner? Yeah, man, they tell him must rise up and go out and kill off the white owners. And that he did. Let me travel from house to house, freeing slaves and killing white people they encountered. Fearless. Because they got a vision from the Lord. Nat Turner called on his group and he told them to kill all white people. What a vision. The rebels speared almost no one whom they encountered, with the exception of a small child who hid in a fireplace among the few survivors. The Africans killed approximately 60 white men and women and children before Turner and his brigade were defeated. A white militia with twice the manpower of the rebels and reinforced by 3 companies of artillery eventually defeated the insurrection. In retaliation, the state of Virginia executed 56 black people and the militias killed at least 100 blacks. An estimated 200 black people were killed, most of whom were not even involved in the rebellion.
Righteous works, not try oppose. I see judgment, I take them evil episode. Judgment, take them and then them explode. Well, it is a raggy road. The road is so rough. Raggy road. The road is so tough. Raggy road. Road is so rough. Raggy road. Yeah, 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 yeah. Well, it is a raggy road. Emmanuel goes to rough. Raggy road. Celestia goes to
Try it. privilege. You see, I have to overcome all the wicked. Them and them false things. I am no white God. Don't teach me anything wrong. Who the white God save me from white man oppression? I have no white God.
So when Nat Turner got the vision, certainly that vision could not have come from a white God. Because which white God is going to send out black man to kill white people? It suggests that there is really a white God and a black God. Maybe a Chinese God too, and an Indian God. There may be several gods, but we can't deal with the white God. So the black man in America now must recognize that he must rise up and rebel against this white God conception. And the white God and his white church and his black money. And begin to hold on to his black money and deal with some black economics. Because there's two things them tell the black man can save him, you know. Because in North America, it's very obvious that money is a God. It's written on the money in America that in God they trust. So money is a God in America. And in God, God will save you. So money can save you. But the black man has been told to put his money into the church because it is the son that will save him. It is the son of this white God that will save him. So I wonder if the money, like money and Jesus are the same. Two of them, so those two things can bring salvation. You have to have either money or you have Jesus. And apparently the black people, money go into Jesus because it is Jesus that saves. While we stay broke. Metamorphosis moving through quite rapidly into our Afrocentric views and news section. And of course, at this point, I have to hail the listeners. Because the listeners provide the motivation to do the necessary work to bring forth this type of program. All the people in the local community, Boundbrook, Port Antonio, taxi drivers, night workers, and Otter Bay, Buff Bay, over in the parish of St. Mary, St. Anne, St. Catherine, St. Thomas. So many saints on the island, and this island has so much wickedness in its activity. So many churches here, and so much violence. They will continue to search for the connection between violence and religion. Because religion teams promote violence because it gives the impression that each group is the most righteous and therefore everybody else is wrong. And so animosity, malice, hatred, all those things are fed into INI's system. But within the local scenario, the problematic right now, besides the traditional talk of violence and crime, is really the ganja issue. The courts have been, we don't know what is really happening in terms of this decriminalization process. It still have enough men still being arrested for ganja. A lot of youths are still being terrorized. The police still have this license to shake you down. And we don't know if it is really fully in law, because as far as we know, the Governor General must put his signature to these type of legislation, which points to the fact that Jamaica really doesn't make its own decisions. That this plant now, this slave labor camp, is still under the auspices of the Queen. Because the Governor General in this island here is not a representative of Jamaica, you know. He's a representative of the monarchy. And so the slaves here, the former slaves who have been emancipated, don't recognize that they're still under the Queen. And still doing Her Majesty's duties. So the ganja reform now, apparently we're waiting on the Queen to sign off. We're waiting for the Governor General to put his signature on it, and he's going to sign on behalf of the Queen. So if the Queen said no, it means that nothing can go through. And this whole notion of 2 ounces and less, and the manufacturing now, and the farming of this ganja, that has been traditionally done by the ganja farmers, the Rastafarians, who have been brutalized and, you know, penalized for growing the holy herb. Now the holy herb has become a commercial product. And the effort now is to move Rasta man out of the system. So we don't have any clarity as to who will be given these licenses and who will be on these boards to define who will get the license. Yeah, the whole thing is still up into the sky, and it cannot be resolved in any haphazard way, you know, because it's a money thing we're dealing with. It's a struggle about who we're going to control the economy of ganja. And in the struggle for the control, it's the man with the pen and the paper and the leaks and the contacts. So Rasta man, you might find yourself on the outside. And the black people who have been brutalized the most for the herb will find that they will not be part of the economic benefits. So rather than struggle now with these manufacturers who are coming in to claim the herb, I am suggesting that Rasta man them quietly begin to look at the industrialization now of the hemp. Because the ganja market for pharmaceutical ganja look like it are closed already, ain't even open yet. This is the hemp, and can't touch that. That loose and open, and is set up for economic recovery and development. We talk about factories. The island should be dotted with hemp factories. And these hemp factories will produce raw material that can be exported to bring in the foreign exchange that can drive away the institutions that we are forced to go and borrow. So the way out is not about just simply trying to create medicine out of herb. We want to create money out of herb. Money is our medicine. And the money that we want to make out of herb will come out of the industrialization of the herb. The making of paper and paints and oil and butter. That is how youth hands will go to work. Because the majority of the population will not be employed into this industry of making pharmaceuticals. There will be no employment. So the mass unemployment will continue. But if you go in the direction of hemp, you must have factories. And from the moment you have factories, you have employment. And from you have employment, you have money. And the governance, the government, these two groups that switch forth and back leadership, lack vision. And the lacking of the vision is based upon the training. And the training of these leaders begin at the University of the West Indies majority. And I must tell the ones, them and ones now, that the University of the West Indies is a prime site for the creation of politicians in Jamaica. And so if you examine the University of the West Indies and its system of halls, the residence system, hall residence system, you realize that it has something to do with how the politicians behave. The university that the politicians come from must have something to do with how they behave. And how do they behave? They behave like how the students at the university behave. They defend their halls to death. but they don't defend the university as a whole. And these same youths leave the university and become politicians and carry along the same idea of defending their party first, and they can't see Jamaica. It's a total disgrace on our political leadership that all politicians can swear allegiance to their party first and none swear allegiance to Jamaica first. And you wonder why Jamaica is such a backward state. The leaders who are trained at the University of the West Indies primarily, who are trained to give allegiance to the halls and not the university, they come out and they give allegiance to the party. And they say with great pride, them ask the party first and everybody cheer. But then people turn around and ask, so who's concerned about Jamaica? You know, as much as the Republicans and the Democrats war, when the election is over, I've never heard any of them say them party first. They always say, God bless America. We have leaders here who are saying, God bless them party. It's a shame.
Warning. The Sergeant General warns. Cigarette smoking is dangerous. Dangerous.
Party first. Dangerous. Most dangerous. A wicked indictment on the country.
Legalize marijuana. Right here in Jamaica.
This Peter Touch song is really a wish. Legalization looks very far away. We can't even get through the decriminalization yet. But as Touch say, I must say it, I make him say it.
Saying is well done. Well done, Mr. Politician Man. You done a wonderful job of tear down with country demolition, man. Skibbly bang, well done. Well done, Mr. Politician Man.
Sports and the Metamorphosis. This is the land of sprinters. Undoubtedly, the land of runners. And apparently, we have been running from the days of the British. Running away from them on foot while they chase us on horses up to the mountains. Yeah, South State. Where we have more evidence of the depth of our running potential. As our trials have shown that we have a 15-year-old young man who is doing a, was set a world record for a 15-year-old at the 400 meters. And it's just a sign of the times that the Africans here are realizing their potential to transform their living through sports. And as much as the plantocracy and the state and these other agencies trying to push down on the talent is rising. The talent is taking itself out of the country. Beyond the school system that's set up to hold you. Because the school system is not about liberating our people. It's another form of capturing them and suffering them. And so-called squeezing out the best. And this is why when our people leave our system and go abroad, they excel so much. Because of the distress to get out here. The average citizen here, average student here, can excel abroad. But it's just an average student here. Because of the bottleneck and the system doesn't facilitate the development of everybody. It really skewed to few. So the very few who come out are usually a genius. It doesn't mean that the rest are not, just that the oppression here is strong. So athletics is a major force to transforming the life of black people individually. In North America, of course, Jesse Owens, Bob Hayes, Wyoming Tyos, all of these great black people who represented America at the Olympics, Muhammad Ali at boxing, that brought much glory to America. But like Ali, who returned and had to throw away his medal because he realized that as much as he represented America and brought in a gold medal, when he returned to the South, he was classified as a nigger. So the harsh reality of North America is that the black man there is not considered an American. He is not considered an American. American is considered to be Caucasian. Jesse Owens ran and created havoc in the world, destroying white supremacist ideology, winning medals, returned to America, and would not even be invited to the White House by the then president. So there's a lot of snobbery and rejection to the black people in North America. Much abuse. And they have to hold it and they have to internalize it, and sometimes it comes out in a very warped and disturbed way. Sports has always been the avenue for expression. And in the world of competition, where superiority is a part of the definition of sports, the Africans in America have proved that they are superior to white people. In all events of sports, in all challenges physically, in all challenges psychologically. The deception in America is that the black man has no talent in his intellect. That is a deception. Muhammad Ali proved that there's a combination and the combination could work between sports and intellect. Because if you could fly like a butterfly and sting like a bee and rhyme poetry while punching at 100 miles per hour, that is genius. If you can rise over the backboard and spin and do a 360 in midair and dunk and end up like Michael Jordan being a billionaire, it's a serious amount of potential coming out of sports. What the black man in America need to do now is take out the money out of the church. Yeah, man, withdrawing money from the so-called church and redirect it now into building institutions that are meaningful to black people, schools, yeah, libraries, more Schomburg libraries, and put our talents to work, not just to entertain white people and the few blacks who enjoy it, but as a tool of transformation. We must use sports in that constructive way. Then of course our junior reggae boys are on the brink of qualifying for the Junior World Cup in Chile. They are separated by the great monster of North America called the USA. We're talking about sports now, that's why you're a monster. And the classic biblical construct of David and Goliath. And of course, we've put America now as Goliath. Unfortunately, we can't describe them as black, because in the Christian Bible, Goliath always appeared to be black and David white. It's in the reverse now, because here we are now, a little black nation challenging the great superpower at under 17. We threw them down in the first round, 1-0. Now there's a rematch, and the winner of this game will go qualify for the Junior World Cup. We have been there twice already, 77 and some other year. I mean, 98 and some other year. I remember which other thing was 2002 or thereabouts. We are trying to get here for the third time. And of course, the team is being motivated and steered by Portland's own Andrew Collar Edwards. Yeah, a product of Love Lane, right up the road there, so. Are you coming from a situation where he was considered to be not coming from any class, but from the grassroots? Never got the respect, but has earned it. And I am really, really hoping that the Jamaicans will find a way to America. This is not going to be an easy task, because America represents a superpower. And I represent a power. And we're going to take them on. The match is on Sunday. And it's very good to know that when I return to the Metamorphosis, we can speak to Andrew as the coach who has led our team to Chile. But because it's sports, nobody knows the results before. And we just can put our meditation positively, send our energies collectively to this mind that our national youths will give us some of that pride and respect that we so dearly need. And we can't find it in our society. We can't find it in the economic life. We can't find it in the political life. If we can't see it in the social life, we see hardship and we see suffering. And but we see a relief when we play sports. And we hope that we're not disappointed in this venture of World Cup under 17. You know, this runners, our runners in high school are Olympics quality runners. Ohio High School has produced Olympic runners, world-class runners at high school level. I continue to wonder why we cannot produce Olympic soccer players. Why can't we produce world-class Olympic soccer players in the same way we can produce world-class Olympic runners? Is the problem vision? Is it philosophy? Is it psychology? Is it class discrimination? What is it? Why we cannot break that barrier and free up our sporting life, particularly our footballers who are in the school system and really have no clubs to absorb their talent? Can we not transform their school talent into Olympic talent? It's a challenge that we must take up. Oh, 1990. A great event took place in the world, and the whole world literally celebrated. This was the release from captivity of one Nelson Mandela. Mandela was a captive prisoner to the apartheid regime over 25 years. Locked away. We don't know what happened to him in those 20 odd years, whether he was reconfigured, rewired, reprogrammed. Certainly could never be the same on his release. But we hear through the world media that on this glorious day, Nelson Mandela was released from the prison, and that apartheid had come to an end. Great deception, if not the greatest deception on the black people since emancipation. Because in this act, the struggle against apartheid and struggle against white racism was sort of put to rest. And the black people of the world got into the celebration of Mandela's release. Also joined the beginning of the internet age. And this new world order that created this impression of being free. Free from racism. That was an illusion. 1990. Also, victim of that deception was Winnie Mandela. And up to today, it grieves my soul and my skin that Winnie has been isolated and disconnected from the African Revolution. The struggle that she maintained the face while her husband was in prison. And the media so quietly and nicely dismiss Winnie Mandela. I would like Winnie Mandela to tell us, why is it, or what is it you discovered about Nelson that it wasn't him? Because to me, Winnie discovered something about Mandela, because she knew him when he was a fiery lawyer in his early years. And what came out and she met, I don't think we have been privy to hear her perspective. I think we should resurrect Winnie Mandela to get the struggle moving positively. Winnie Mandela is the source. We have been deceived by the elevation of Nelson to the presidency, from a prisoner to a president, to a voice of reconciliation for a white world. And in that, the African people were put to rest. The black people in North America were celebrating. Black people in the Caribbean celebrating the end of apartheid. Great illusion, because apartheid, which is a policy of racial segregation in his homeland in North America, is still strong. So you see what happened now when a non-Caucasian like Barack Obama would move through the ranks of American racist system and get into the White House. It totally disturbing to the white population generally. The youths who were born after 1990 onwards in the internet age may have a different attitude, but they have been exposed to more contact with other racial groups. They have been connected to other people through the internet. They know reggae music. They hear what Rastafari. They have a sort of little different perspective. But you see, the foundation people, the real white people in America, the real old-time racist bigot them, they are still there. And they control important places like Congress. And so Barack Obama is a total distress to white America. And this is why the cry is now for Americans to take over back America. Because in American white man perspective, it is a white man who is American. They said, Barack, do we even have any? The question is birthright, if you remember. They had an issue that he wasn't even born in America. So apartheid is alive and kicking and well. Not in South Africa, necessarily. But it is booming in the American states. And it is manifesting itself through the invisible arm of the government, which is the Ku Klux Klan. And the Ku Klux Klan is deeply embedded in the military and in the police force. Segregation is at its highest in the American military, you know. This is where you go and you see apartheid and segregation in the American military. And the police force is just an extension. It's like the local military. And so when them come out on the streets and they see black people, all that's leads to happen in America now, you know, is another Sharpeville. Sharpeville was a massacre in South Africa when the policeman them opened fire and killed off some 60 odd people. America is on the brink of a Sharpeville massacre. And it's something like that that's going to shock the black people out of the white church and into them blackness. Can you imagine when Winnie Mandela see Nelson walk hand in hand with de Klerk? It must have burned her belly, me I tell you. Yeah, man. How serious thing go on this, you know. We have to resurrect Winnie. Yeah, man. We have to restore the Empress. That the struggle can continue in a very positive vein. The release Mandela don't mean nothing about apartheid. That's a political movement. Then break down the Berlin Wall. And giving the impression that the world is now level. We are still captive in these giant slave labor camps, working for low wages and living in debt.
Can't live so baby.
Male and female relations, critical to black reconstruction. That women have been brutalized, you know, particularly even that period that was called reconstruction. The black woman them get some terrible beating, you know, called unmarried women and worthless and vagrants. All sort of brutality, you know, the black woman in America has had to face. You know, to face discrimination from the white man and to face oppression from her, even her own man. Different kind of beat up. But when we're looking into the present dispensation now of relations, I have uncovered something that is, I think, very unusual. And it has to do with our sexuality as a people, or as a nation, or as an individual. And there's a thing about, two things I want to speak to. One is something that affects women. called menopause. And the other thing now is something that's affecting black men in particular. It's called prostate cancer. Now, these two things may not seem to be related, but they are. Because within the female, after she goes through her childbearing period and goes beyond childbearing, she experiences this thing that is called menopause. Now, that's a specific experience. It can be dealt with, and I always ask for some females to call in and give me some greater insights into the experience. But the males are also experiencing something that is very difficult in their lives, and it's called prostate cancer. And it affects the sexual relations now between the African man and woman. Because this cancer that we hear now, that we have here now, is dominant in the black people, and it's more than dominant on the Jamaica Island. And it affects the sexual life of the man. It actually makes him impotent, unable to perform sexually. And this thing kicks in the ages 45, 50 going on. So if the African male, particularly in Jamaica, moving in towards this outbreak of prostate cancer, and the women are moving out of their menopause stage and beginning to rediscover their sexuality, we're having some serious calamities down the road in terms of relations and connections. Because this prostate cancer now on the island of Jamaica, when you try to find the source of it, I personally think that we have to look into our diet. And when you look into the food that the Jamaican man has been hooked on is a national dish. That poison dish